Welcome to War of the Weird, a war between friends with a stranger to discovery the greatest chance of victory. Last time, Broomy took the spoils of war he had earned through hard-fought battle, and forced Mystic to endure a trout mask replica, an album as abrasive as it is influential. But alas, the victory was short-lived, and the war is back on, full force, with this week's battle. Susanna M. Salter versus Mad Jack Churchill.
Hello, and welcome to War of the Weirds. I'm Broomy.
And I'm Mystic.
And we're here, and we're telling one another extremely bizarre stories from our bizarre reality. Just like, wow.
The world is weird.
Like, you know, I felt like people might have needed a little bit of convincing at the beginning of our podcast.
Right.
But, I mean, damn.
Yeah, you know, something that stuck with me from, like, when we, I think we had just started the podcast, and it was in one of your streams, and I forget, I don't know, maybe it was Manny that was saying, like, yeah, there's, like, you and he were talking, so I don't remember which one of you said what, but you were like, yeah, you know, like, there are tons of, like, stories about paranormal things and, you know, but, like, reality is weird enough that there's plenty of fruit to be harvested for this podcast that, like, does not talk at all about, like, weird alien theories or ghosts or anything, because, like, just factual things that have happened historically and continue to happen are mind-bending.
Yeah, it's just, I just mentioned, like you just said, like, ghosts and aliens are not something that I dive deep into, because I just don't find the need, because there's so much weird stuff going on that we know for sure is real.
Right.
So yeah. Speaking of weird stuff, we're kind of in a little competition to see who got the weirder stories that we've discovered, and we tied up. One of us won one episode, one of us won the other episode, and
we have a tiebreaker rule.
Tiebreaker is the acclaimed guitarist from Blink-182, also happens to be one of the people on the forefront of legitimate alien research. I just said, I don't really believe aliens are
and now we're like, yeah. Like, no, completely.
In terms of respectable UFO research, that, like, in the event that that exists to you,
he is going to be the one that finds it. Like, it's going to be.
He's at least in the circle of people that find it.
We're talking about government level research.
Yeah. Like, forcing the US Navy's hand to release footage of weird aircrafts.
Yeah. So, like, he's regardless of your opinion on aliens or whatever your beliefs are, like, the fact that such an agency did exist and that he is involved in it is one of those weird things.
Yeah. An earlier episode, check it out if you want to hear how that happened, and how it went from, where are ya? And I'm so sorry, to U.S. Navy, open up, give me your aliens. But the tiebreaker is his latest tweet about paranormal activity, not the movie,
That'd be really specific. That would,
or anything else. And you took paranormal activity.
I took paranormal activity. So yeah. Tom DeLonge, don't let me down, man.
No, you paranormal activity or music, because he's also has a band still, Angels and Airwaves,
right?
That he talks about regularly, and people talk to him about Blink-182. So I'm clicking on his Twitter feed right now.
Make sure it's not a pinned tweet. That doesn't count.
No, I know.
Unless it's a pinned tweet about aliens, in which case it totally counts.
I see. It is a pinned tweet about aliens. but no. Actually, he doesn't have a pinned tweet. Also, 3 days ago, this isn't his latest tweet, but 3 days ago, he just tweeted, hi.
Maybe he was high.
Yeah. Forgot GHs. Okay. All right.
Here we are. Drumroll, please.
His latest tweet, he has quoted Elon Musk saying, so where are the aliens? And yes! He said in response, maybe you need a briefing from TTS Academy, which is the To the Stars Academy of Arts and Sciences, the organization we referenced earlier. So, yes. That means, Mystic, you're the wiener.
Nice. I've always wanted to be a wiener.
Sweet. Get in your wiener mobile and just drive around for a while.
Yeah. So I, as I mentioned to Broomy before we started, when we were going to determine the outcome, I had a couple of things saved for potential, horrific, disturbing or boring or not,
yeah,
just
the
weird.
Loser has to watch whatever the winner, endure whatever the winner puts them through, right. And generally we're going for abrasive and strange,
right? And so I have a couple things on the list. I could not find the one that I was hoping to do first. It was a YouTube playlist of about 10 videos. They are pretty short, so it would be maybe like an hour. But I'm not able to find it right now, so I'm gonna take a little bit more time after we record and try to find that. Otherwise, I will let you know later this evening what that media source will be, and then maybe then.
All right. So I got a weird or incredibly abrasive set of YouTube, an hour of YouTube videos to watch, and I'm down with the sickness.
Yeah.
And which is cool because we just did the Captain Beefheart thing. I won.
Right.
You win one.
Yeah.
It's not just me like forcing you to do things.
Right.
Here we go. So.
Yeah. All right. So
I have
you,
a story.
Tell me a story. I'm all settled in. I got a cup of Constant Comet tea.
Oh snap!
And
well. It's my story, so maybe ease up on the commenting just a tad.
But
no. what is that? Black tea?
Yeah, it's black tea.
Yeah. All right. I just thought that was perfect podcast banter, so I just had to get it straight. If it was black tea, it was. I'm not blaming
you on that.
That was all me. okay, so. This story is our first story, I would say, that is primarily about a woman.
Whoa, nice.
So,
unless she sucks, in which case, you know.
I mean, it's still nice, even if she sucks.
Yeah, okay.
Born in 1860, Susanna M. Kinsey. She was born in Ohio, descendant of Quaker colonists of England to America. So, and, you know, 1860, not that far. What? A little 100 years? Whatever? A little over,
yeah. Not long. That's like two generations.
Yeah.
Well, people do generations split up like every 10 years now, you know? Because you have but I mean like two like birth to death generations.
What do they call it? Like if they had them? I'm just thinking like our millennial, Gen Z or whatever. Because
it was Gen Y, right? Or Gen X, and then Gen the millennials and Gen Z. That's all like 10 years apart. So,
yeah. What was it? Gen petticoats. Gen
The Gen steamships.
Gen
electricity.
so
Yeah.
At 12, she moved to Kansas with her parents because she was 12.
So she was that Gen, make Gen sense Tornado. If,
yeah. Yes. She is in Kansas anymore right now. And they were settling an extremely large farm, 80 acres. And, you know, so they're doing well for themselves. 8 years later, she goes to Kansas State Agricultural College in Manhattan, which is also a city in Kansas. It's not actually New York. Which I was like, did, which came first? I didn't check. I assume the New York one came first. In that case, just think of another name.
Yeah.
Anyway,
just pick a name. You know, you're in charge of your own imagination.
Yeah. But she had to drop out a few weeks before she would have graduated because of illness. You know, I mean, this is all just backstory, just providing you a little flavor of this woman's life. While she was a student, she met Lewis Allison Salter, who was an aspiring attorney and son of the former Kansas Lieutenant Governor, ooh, Melville Salter. And they married in 1880. And she, now Susanna M. Salter, was Kinsey. And her husband moved to Argonia, which I guess is the origin city of the lizard people in Skyrim. For
Skyrim, yeah. all right, real quick. The correct name is Black Marsh. But, you know, Argonia was just like a slang term for it. Whatever.
Weird.
Yeah, get politically correct, okay?
I'm sorry. So Susanna M. Salter and her husband moved to Black Marsh.
There we go.
Which was another city in Kansas. It was a small town, about 500 people, in 1882. And she managed a hardware store and was active in the local woman's Christian Temperance Union, which, you know what temperance is?
Like patience and calm, tranquil, like peaceful?
Sure, but it was, in this context, in this time, it is sort of basically about prohibition.
Okay.
Limit and stop alcohol consumption.
Gotcha.
And she was also a part of the Prohibition Party, like, which was just another organization like that.
So there was a prohibition and she was prohibition.
Yeah.
Cool.
I'm prohibition. I'm just not for prohibition. Know what
right,
I mean?
Right. Correct. Yeah.
Sorry to get super political, but
yeah.
So yeah, in 1882, that's what's going down. 83, she gave birth to the first baby born in
Wow, the first baby ever?
First baby ever. We don't know how people duplicated before then, but, you know. We now, everybody's doing babies now. She was the first. First baby born in Argonia. And then her parents moved there, bought her store, called it Kinsey and Salter. And, all right. All right. We all got the backstory here, all the bullshit out of the way.
Yeah, yeah.
In 1885, Argonia was incorporated, meaning it was now a part, an official part of the USA and a legal governing body in itself.
Is that like annexation? Is that like that similar? Or annexation is where like a part of a country exists in another country, right?
I think so.
Or like
yes.
A country, like it's like, okay, yeah.
I don't know. We could be sounding dumb. I don't know.
Well, I mean, people already know that I'm dumb by now, so I'm just trying to drag you down with me. So I don't look so stupid comparatively.
I mean, I'm already far below you. But her father was the first mayor of Argonia.
Mm-hmm.
So, first baby, her father was the first mayor.
A lot of firsts.
A lot of firsts. Her husband was city clerk. So
oh, nice.
She's you know, I guess in good hands for her. An article on her, you'll see why she had an article on her in a moment, said, and I quote, "As the wife of the city clerk, Susanna became responsible for writing the city's ordinances."
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, really? Because you're the wife of the city clerk, you know, you're writing laws?
Yeah, you know, like if you marry a doctor, then you get to go practice surgery.
Yeah. I forgot that was a thing, and yeah, I realized I was wrong.
Come on.
Sorry. But yeah, I thought that was strange.
Yeah, that was very weird. What? The world is still weird. The world, like, the way it operated was just so bizarre.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Okay.
Seemed...
there were no rules. Whatever you decided to do, they're like, all right, cool, he does that now, I guess.
Simultaneously more strict and more casual.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, at the same time.
Yeah.
But in 1887, so that was 85-ish, and in 1887, Kansas gave women the right to vote in local elections.
Oh, good, good.
As long as they lived in a city of first, second, or third class. I don't know exactly what that means. I didn't look it up. I was going to, but then I, you know, was researching the rest of the story and said, right, fuck it. Like, I just imagine it's just like cities that qualify, that exist, basically.
Right.
On the record.
Had to be like, maybe like, you know, to like apply to be accept, like, oh, it's like accreditation, sort of like you have to,
yeah,
be
something to that effect,
big enough and to have like need representation or
and just for reference, so we all remember, women didn't have sort of the right to vote nationally via the 19th Amendment yet. That was passed in 1920.
Yeah, so this was, well, this was way back.
Yeah, this before was
that. Yeah.
What, 23 years before that?
Yeah.
So Argonia was third class, so its women were eligible to vote. That same year, the Women's Christian Temperance Union, which Susanna M. Salter was a member, made enforcement of state prohibition laws the prime issue of the elections, and nominated a slate of candidates for local office who agreed with them. And they called a caucus to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Their president was absent, so Susanna M. Salter presided over the caucus. Two guys were there. A bunch of people were there, but two men attended the caucus just to heckle the caucus the whole time and try to intimidate this, the women's, what is it? Women's Christian Temperance Union.
Mm-hmm.
They also tried to nominate a candidate, and guess what? They were voted down because they were the assholes the whole time.
Right, right. Yeah.
So, but after that, you know, these two weren't the only men in town that weren't into the Women's Christian Temperance Union. 20 men met in the back room of a local restaurant and held a secret caucus. To be clear, they were both against the idea of the prohibition,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
But also they were against women having any influence or say at all on political issues.
Mm-hmm.
So they drew up a slate of candidates that was identical to the one that the Women's Christian Temperance Union made, except it also had Susanna M. Salter's name entered as a candidate for mayor.
Mm.
they figured that the only people who would vote for her would be the Women's Christian Temperance Union members.
Right.
And they would be so humiliated that the Women's Christian Temperance Union would disband.
Oh, yeah. You'd lose credibility.
Yeah. Because that's, it's like, she's like a representative of theirs.
Right.
And the reason why she specifically was chosen was she was the only member that lived within the city limits of Argonia. April 4th, 1887, election day. Susanna Ann Salter's on the ballot, because this group of dudes had the ballots printed with her name on it.
Oh.
She didn't know she was on the ballot. She wasn't running for mayor.
What a great system. See, that's how things should be. The whole community should be like this person. I mean, I know this was being like they were doing it with like malicious intent, but like, yeah, there should be no names. You just go in there and write, like, you nominate whoever, and just that's what you do. Like the write-ins, that should be a thing.
Yeah, except these guys basically printed in.
Well, yeah, yeah.
But
the fact that they were able to do it
alongside all the other ones.
Yeah.
So the local Republican Party chairman saw her name on the ballot, and they found out about these sexist bros' hilarious prank.
Men's right activist.
Just so funny. And they sent a delegation to her home to ask whether she was running.
Mm-hmm.
And when she was asked if she would serve if elected, she said, yes. And mm-hmm. in response, they said, all right, we will elect you and just show those fellows who framed up this deal a thing or two.
Yes.
So, all day long, they explained the situation and campaigned for Susanna M. Salter to become the mayor of Argonia.
Love it.
Her husband, earlier that morning, while the delegation visited her, whatever, was voting and was very angry to see his wife's name on the ballot. Because obviously he knew she wasn't running for mayor. What the fuck's going on?
Mm-hmm.
And then he gets back to the house and he's even more disturbed when he finds out that she agreed to serve if elected. But him being disturbed wasn't like a thing for Susanna. She's like, yeah, I mean, yeah, I'll do it. I'm not gonna not do it.
Yeah.
If I get elected. At 4 p.m., she went to the polls with her parents and voted, but it wasn't considered proper to vote for oneself.
Right.
So she didn't cast a vote specifically for mayor. How honorable.
I thought, oh man, I was going to be real mad if she voted for the other person and lost by one vote. like that.
I mean, and it's such a small town that
yeah,
that
could would
easily could,
that's
happened.
A realistic, yeah.
Yeah. So the members of the Women's Christian Temperance Union were like, fuck the nominee we actually chose. Let's get Susanna up in there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they showed up. So instead of like 20-ish votes, which is what like the genius pranksters thought she would get, she won by a 2/3 majority and became the first woman elected mayor in America.
What the heck? That's great. That is great.
So, her election was covered by newspapers across the country, overseas. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's insane, right? It's like...
Yeah, that is crazy.
A reporter from the New York Sun sat in on one of the first council meetings she had. She knew that her every move would be publicized and criticized, So she wanted to make sure to handle it with a firm hand, showing that women could hold their own in politics.
Yeah.
And the New York Sun reporters seem to agree. Here's a couple snippets from the article that he wrote. I asked Mrs. Salter if her ambition to act as a female politician or leader in woman suffrage circles had been aroused by her election. She quickly replied, "No, indeed, I shall be very glad when my term of office expires, and shall be only too happy to therefore devote myself entirely, as I always have done heretofore, to the care of my family." Another little snippet from the article. "She's an intelligent, capable, and conscientious officer, fully equal to all of the requirements of her position." So, you know, she steps up to the plate, at least for this newspaper, and she hits it out of the park.
Nice.
And just another sort of positive news thing. Quote, "The Kansas women have done it. Susanna Medora Salter, mayor of Argonia, a little town of 500 inhabitants, is the first woman ever elected to that office. And she is not an unsexed female, either. Oof. But the wife of a lawyer and the mother of four children. There is no more likelihood of her neglecting her babies. She is only 27, and the children cannot be much beyond babyhood. Then her husband would neglect his practice if he had been elected to the same office. There is also a poetic fitness in Mrs. Salter's election. Her father was the first mayor of the town, and she can continue the work he began." So, some other newspapers agreed.
Mm-hmm.
But, of course, there were also other newspapers that made, like, shitty jokes and remarks about her.
Yeah, yeah.
They also pointed out that a short time after her election, the billiard hall in town was closed, and the sale of hard cider was stopped in Argonia.
Huh.
So, morals of town get a little stricter.
Yeah.
Under old Salter.
Yeah, yeah.
Because she's, you know, she's a conservative Christian woman, and she's for prohibition. So she got fan mail from all across America and abroad.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But of course, she also got hate mail.
Oh, yes.
And this is a prime example. She was sent a card with men's pants drawn on it,
mm-hmm,
from an anonymous person, and it read, "When a woman leaves her natural sphere, and without her sex's modesty or fear, assays the part of man, she, in her weak attempts to rule, but makes herself a mark for ridicule, a laughingstock and sham. Article of greatest use is to her then, something worn distinctively by men, a pair of pants will do. Thus, she will plainly demonstrate that nature made a great mistake in sexing such a shrew."
All right.
I gotta say, what a fucking nerd.
Like, what a nerd.
Jesus <That's>... Christ.
Oh my gosh. Like, nobody is impressed by that. Except, I mean, yeah.
You wrote a poem.
You write a poem. not a real badass move, you know?
And it's not like he published he sent her the poem,
right,
personally.
Yeah, you know, it's not like he published it in the, like, as like a satirical piece in an editorial. No, yeah. He was just like, sent a mean poem to somebody.
I mean, if that was the practice, I would like hate mail a little more.
Oh yeah, yeah. If I will only accept hate mail in the form of sonnets and couplets. So,
I'd like them to be haikus for me. Keep them nice
this short, classy. Please. Yeah, yeah.
But Susanna M. Salter served her year as mayor. It was a year term. And the general consensus was she got the job done type of thing. Nothing crazy or monumental happened, but she was a solid mayor, solid leader, solid political figure. And other Kansas towns elected women into local government the next year. Here are a couple headlines. Women as mayors and city councilors, not a success in Kansas. Pretty campaigners indulging in kissing to change the view of stony-hearted partisans.
Yuck.
How women lose self-respect. Argonia, Syracuse, and Oskaloosa under female government. But we know they were wrong.
Right, right, right.
History proved them wrong.
Right.
There was a ton of women in politics.
Time was against them.
Doing fine work. And terrible work. But
there's terrible everything. I mean, everybody's... Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not because there are women that they were doing terrible things.
No. There's women doing great things as well. I'm just saying. There's a ton of women in politics.
Yeah.
Y'all were way wrong, dog. But that... So that is the story of Susanna M. Salter, a woman who made history by being the first woman elected mayor, largely thanks to a dumb sexist prank that backfired harder than any prank I can think of.
Yeah, that's great. That's fantastic. I think that's probably my favorite story I've heard, because it's like, it starts out mean, but then it's so heartwarming, like that.
Yeah, it just worked out. Just all of the positive things happened.
Yeah.
So before we get into your story, though, I just wanted to comment on, like, how this backfired for them was literally the exact opposite of what they wanted.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, like, they didn't want women to have influence or say in politics. And they literally pushed the whole nation forward for women.
You know what I mean? Yeah, yeah.
They were a part of that. Obviously, all the people that got out to campaign for her or whatever, and her being a successful... But just in terms of pranks backfiring... It's just such a thing that it's the exact opposite thing that they wanted, that I was just blown away by and loved.
Yeah, and like, even, especially because, like, they did it and they're like, we're gonna, like, it's gonna backfire and they're gonna make fun of this movement. But instead, like, that movement was like, we're gonna make fun of these guys and, like, show them up. Like, in every way, it backfired in the complete opposite. Yeah, that's hilarious.
Yeah. But you have a story.
I do indeed have a story. So I'm just gonna, you know, sometimes I kind of like to set it up where the shoe drops. But this time I'm just gonna tell you right off the bat who the story is about. Jack Churchill. He served in the British Army. And his nickname was Mad Jack Churchill. Just like going ahead and telling that, like putting that out there, that that's what he was called. And this story is just like his life and how it's not far-fetched at all. Like, that is an understatement for who he is.
Sure.
Being like living a crazy
British
life.
Right?
British. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So when they say mad, we know for sure they're talking
like
crazy. Loony.
Yeah. He is crazy. Not just like angry. Although he was a very angry person. But I mean, he was a nice guy. But like, when it came to fighting, he was like pretty savage. All right. So Jack Churchill, he was born in Colombo, British Ceylon, which is a British colony in modern day Sri Lanka.
No, that's a TV show in America. So you're wrong already. But
darn. I should just, you know, you want to just tell this? Because I'm embarrassed.
Yeah, yeah.
What a travesty.
He was crazy.
The end.
And that's the story, guys. Have a next one.
Yeah. See you next week. Vote for Broomy's story.
Vote for what you think maybe is the better one.
Right.
I say it's a toss up.
Yeah. It's hard to tell. So he Columbo. Yeah. Was that like a police thing? I was thinking like a detective or something.
Yeah.
Because isn't that detective. Like that was like a sort of like how people say like no shit Sherlock, but it was like right Columbo. Like it was like you made a sarcastic comment.
Yeah.
Like Captain Obvious, I think. Yeah.
He's in the echelon of people that you say sarcastically. Also, the actor had a glass eye.
Yeah. Oh. I didn't know that. Yeah. I had a friend, one of my friends in elementary school. He had a glass eye. And whenever we had a substitute teacher, he would prop up his head with his palm like on his face, covering his real eye, and he would just sleep there with his eyes open, well, with the glass eye open. And just sleep during class. Yeah, it was pretty funny. He's a cool kid.
Genius.
And he would like take it out to scare the sub. Yeah. Funny dude. Anyways.
He just hated teachers.
I think. Yeah. He just anti-education. Maybe. But anyways, he came from a line of men. Like his father had served in the army in some capacity. He was like an engineer, and his grandfather had served. And so he was like, yeah, no different. Like he had two younger brothers that ended up serving, one in the Royal Navy and another one was killed in action. So like military service kind of ran the family, which I think that's kind of a thing. Not all the time, but yeah, you know, especially back in the day, it was like people exactly their father did.
Yeah. You follow in their footsteps.
Right. Cause I mean, especially like you're in those communities. And so you already, like you have, I think things were more like word of mouth because there weren't like really degrees and stuff like that. I mean, there were, but you know, it was just kind of who you knew.
Yes. If everybody you knew went into the military,
then you're like well,
that's the choice.
Yeah. So he graduated from the Royal Military College in 1926, because this was a long time ago, and served in the Manchester Regiment in Burma, which is like touches India. Yeah. So he, after 10 years, he retired. Jack Churchill left the service and in 1936 took on work as a newspaper editor in Nairobi, Kenya. While in Nairobi, he also began working as a male model because why not? And
I mean, if you can get the work.
Yeah, if you can get it. I wondered in this, like, I mean, I know that there were, it was like colonies, you know? But I wonder if like was he like working as a male model like in the colonies, or was it just like having a white person in a predominantly black area that he was kind of like a novelty, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't maybe. Know. To make matters weirder, he was a fair shot as an archer and a talented bagpipe player. If that's possible. I don't, that's kind of sounds like an oxymoron, but
I mean, you can be talented.
Right.
Nothing will make it sound good.
Right. But, yeah. you know, I like to always try to alienate one group of people, in the podcast. So this time it's going to be bagpipe players. Yeah.
Eat.
Yeah.
Shit. Sorry.
Stuff it in those bagpipes. But he uses these talents to land him a minor role in the 1924 film The Thief of Baghdad. And 2 years later, he made an appearance in A Yank at Oxford.
okay, that's a porn, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, give Oxford a little yank. Come on. No. that same year, he earned a second place. He earned second place in the military piping competition. And,
also a porn. Yes.
Right. Yeah, he's a good at blowing on that pipe. A year after that, his archery prowess landed him at the World Archery Championship representing Britain.
Whoa. So yeah. this guy can do quite a bit.
Quite a bit, yeah. He's those two things, like, you know, bagpipes and bow kind of define him, the two B's, and he does them very well.
That's why I call him BB.
BB,
but yeah. That's just my little nickname for him.
Mad BB Jack Churchill.
When
World War II broke out upon the invasion of Poland by Germany, Churchill was called back to join the army. once again, part of the Manchester Regiment, where he served in France. And I should mention here, as part of like the setup for him being called crazy, he carried a claymore and a longbow into battle. Like, that was just part of his standard military uniform. So, you know, his compatriots are using machine guns. And, I mean, he has a machine gun. But he's like, yeah, I'm also going to bring a Scottish broadsword here. And so he actually brought multiple bows.
Yeah, aren't claymores, like, huge? Oh, yep. Aren't they, like, giant two-handed swords?
Yep. And there's like, as his life goes on, like, he's depicted having, like, different swords. Like, one time he has, like, a basket-hilted sword. And so, like, I think he kind of rotated around, like, you know, but he lost a sword in one battle because he decided to, like, hand fight a guy instead of, he was like, it's too easy to just kill him with a sword. I'm going to beat him to death. So he, like, lost his sword and had, like, go back for it. So, yeah, he's
That's definitely what I would do in war, is right. That I would just be like, this isn't hard enough.
Take a lesser weapon into war and then be like, it's still too easy. I'm going to use my hands.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's crazy, right? There's a legend. Some people contest this, but it's like documented in multiple accounts. But he sniped Nazi patrols along the front lines with his longbow because the weapon was so silent that he could like stealthily like hide somewhere and pick off people, and they didn't really know where it was coming from. And you couldn't hear it. I mean, a bowstring snapping, he's like 200 yards away. He was accurate.
You couldn't hear it, and it's a thing that you don't suspect.
Right, exactly.
Kill from afar with a silent weapon.
Right.
In that time.
Yeah, and like with a rifle or something, you've got one shot, and then people know where you are, or they know that people are shooting. But he could shoot multiple people, and as long as they didn't discover the corpses, yeah.
Yeah.
So he was yeah. I mean, it's like as crazy as it was to carry a longbow, he made good use of it.
Yeah, the longbow I get a lot more, and I got it a lot more when you said it. Like, I was like, I understand that more than a fucking claymore.
Right, right. Yeah.
It's like, you have to be that close to somebody. It is, I mean.
Yeah, yeah. But again, if you're going to be that close, and like, if your gun or something malfunctions or clip fire, like, miss, you know, because like it's 1900s guns technology,
yeah.
Then, I mean, yeah, it's good to have like something to fall back on. I would rather like I wouldn't use it as a primary weapon, but then people like you could have like military knives and stuff. So yeah, I don't know. It's like hard to swing. Maybe it's just intimidating. Maybe it's just like a fear factor. If you looked up and saw a guy screaming at you with a sword, like you'd be a little put off. Like, what is it? He serious? Like, he must know what he's doing to be that confident.
Yeah, he might just basically sort of stun people.
Right.
I mean, it might just not even be fear. It might just be like. What's
like
happening?
Confusion, like, wait, what did I time travel? What is going on?
So
after his battles in France, he volunteered to serve in the commandos, which is a military unit designed to raid German occupied zones throughout Europe. So they would like attack different outposts. I want to read a quote here. This is a quote from Wikipedia about this section. Churchill was second in command of number 3 commando in Operation Archery, a raid on the German garrison at Vagsøy, Germany. Sorry, Norway. Vagsøy, Norway. I'm sure I'm pronouncing that wrong. On December 27th, 1941, as the ramps fell on the first landing craft, he leapt forward from his position, playing March of the Cameron Men on his bagpipes before throwing a grenade and charging into battle. For his actions at Dunkirk and Vagsøy, Churchill received the Military Cross and Bar. So, yeah, you know, ship lands. He starts
Leroy Jenkins. He was this guy.
Yeah, he's insane. He's just like here, like drawing fire, playing the bagpipes, throwing grenades. He's pretty bloodthirsty and just like unafraid, dude. Very bold. Perhaps his most significant achievement occurred in Italy in 1943. He led an attack with his sword, longbow, and arrows, and his bagpipe tucked under his arm. His order was to capture a German outpost, and he, along with one other man, a corporal, snuck into the outpost during the night, and he took the guards by surprise and made them, like, capture them as prisoners at the point of his sword, and then kept going from post to post, sneaking around, adding a collection of German soldiers to his list, his, like, chain of prisoners. He was just, like, sneaking up on them in the, like, throughout the post. I mean, throughout the outpost. Until
he had things to chain
them up. Yeah, yeah. He would, like, take their weapons and stuff, and, like, yeah. He ended up capturing 42 German prisoners. Him and one other man. Like, at what point, even if you don't have weapons, like, are you just like, all right, there's enough of us. Like, like, I don't, yeah. But he captured 42 German prisoners. He also captured a mortar squad. What a guy. What a guy.
Wait. So he basically took over this
outpost. Just him and one other man. Yep.
With another guy.
Yep.
That is insane.
That is insane.
Like, if that's like Metal Gear Solid levels of ridiculousness.
I don't know what that is.
You don't know what Metal Gear Solid is? It's a video game. It's a stealth video game.
Okay.
It's very, very famous.
I know a Full Metal Alchemist.
That's nothing like what we're talking about, so maybe it's not relevant. Maybe think about that for a second.
All right. No, so it's a sneaky game? You're a sneaky game? Like Sly Cooper?
Yes, like Sly Cooper, but maybe a little more serious than a raccoon and a hippo jumping around.
Don't forget Bentley the turtle.
I will forget the turtle.
He was annoying, don't worry.
Yeah.
Everybody likes Murray. Yeah.
Anyway, basically you sneak around and you kill people, and it's pretty awesome, cool game. But anyway, that's a crazy story, and that's a confirmed to be true thing.
Yes, it is. Yes. Yeah.
That's so badass. Like, you can't not appreciate it for how good he was in that situation.
Yeah, when I first read it, I thought that he just, like, charged it and fought him. Then I was like, what? That's crazy. And then I found out he, like, snuck from, like, guard posting to guard posting. And I was like, that is, like, okay, this makes sense for how it could happen. It's still crazy. Like, it's still hard to, like, But, that's, what a strategist and how confident. I mean, he's just like, all right, we're going to try this. He then participated in an attack on a German outpost in Yugoslavia. He, along with six other soldiers, were the only ones to survive making it to their objective. And there were multiple units. So there were like 150-ish people at least. I'm not saying all of them died, but some of them had to like retreat or weren't able to make it to the objective. I mean, like, many of them did die. As they were surrounded by an advancing German army, Churchill played "Will You Know Come Back Again" on his bagpipes until being knocked unconscious by a thrown grenade. Because that was annoying. Like, they weren't like, we don't care that you're the enemy. You gotta shut up.
They didn't even pull the pin. They were just like, fucking hit him.
It was probably one of his compatriots there with him. Like, I can't take this. Like, play. So he was captured. He and the other six men were captured. But he was treated as a prize hostage because people thought that he was related to Winston Churchill, which he was not.
Yeah.
So he was then taken to Berlin for questioning and then put in a concentration camp. Mm-hmm. Not long after his imprisonment, he escaped the concentration camp by squeezing into an abandoned drain that led under the fence, and then began his trek down the coast until he was recaptured by the Germans in another occupied city. So he escaped the concentration camp only to literally walk into a German occupied city. And then a year later, he was part of a prisoner transport by SS troops. And some of the prisoners had like reached out to the German army officers saying that they were afraid that they were about to be killed. And so the army intervened and the SS troops were outnumbered. And so they had just abandoned the prisoners, who the army then released. They didn't really aid them in escaping, but they just like, you're free to go. So then Churchill walked 93 miles to meet up with American forces. So that's like kind of the general, like, up to his military, his, like, those are his most military, blah, blah, his most notable military achievements. He actually died in 90 something. He died in the 90s. Is that
really?
Does that sound? Yeah, he died. He died in 96. He was 90 years old. Well, he was 89. He didn't quite have his birthday, but he died in 96. But he still worked, like, served. So here's like a couple other occurrences slash exploits worth mentioning. This round out the rest of his life. He freed his company from being trapped by Germans by fighting them off with two machine guns and his bow. And then held them he held them off, and then that night
he used his feet
and his teeth. And so then, like, at night he secreted them away. He was shot, and the bullet remained in his shoulder for the rest of his life.
Secreted them away.
Right.
You are not referring to the book, The Secret, where he, like, really wanted it badly and he thought about it. You're saying, what is secreting something away?
I have no idea what that is. Yeah, he smuggled them out. In the dead of night. Yeah.
You don't know what The Secret is?
No.
It was like, it's like a stupid self-help book where it's just like, all you gotta do is picture something in your mind and believe that it'll happen, and then it will.
Well, if this guy, you know, I could believe that if this guy did it, because this is, he went against the odds and came out on top multiple times.
Yeah.
So, that's silly. So he just smuggled them away. He didn't just, like, picture it and then it happened. It wasn't magic. He also rode a motorcycle 1500 miles across India, during which he crashed into a water buffalo and then kept going.
Why not?
Yeah.
Just for fun.
As a supposed demolition expert, in quotation marks, he once mistakenly set off a charge that was beside him, blew up the wine bottle he was drinking from, and it sent shrapnel and shreds of glass into his face. He was in Burma fighting Japanese forces at the time of the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, thus an abrupt ending to the war. Churchill is reported as lamenting the end of the war, saying, if it wasn't for those damn Yanks, we could have kept the war going another 10 years. Because he wanted to keep fighting.
Check. Maybe
so,
take one of these chill pills I got for ya.
Yeah, yeah. he was
this
pretty,
war could have gone on forever, you fucking idiot.
You ruined it. Dang it. He had a lot of fight left in him, so he became a parachutist for the Seaforth Highlanders.
What does that mean?
It was like a National Guard version of Ireland, like Ireland's National Guard or something like that.
Okay.
Or Scotland. I think Scotland, sorry. It's like a military thing, but they kind of did like some, not full on like wars, but kind of participated in some battles and, you know. Sure. He was present at the Hadassah, I'm not sure if I'm saying that correct, Hadassah medical convoy massacre. So there was a medical transport going to Hadassah hospital, and they fell under fire from Arab forces. And he, like, went up and banged on the truck and was like, hey, like, can we help you? There's, like, a couple of us here. And they were like, no, we're praying for, like, the Jewish forces to come save us. They had, like, a Jewish military group. And though they denied aid from Churchill and his group of men, two trucks caught fire. 77 of the 79 people inside of them died. And so then he, like, it's like, all right, we're gonna join in, like, regardless. We're just gonna, we can't sit here and, like, watch this happen. But it's, yeah, it's called the, it's referred to as the Hadassah Medical Convoy Massacre. There's about 150 to 200 riflemen that were attacking. So after this, he led an evacuation of 700 Jewish doctors, students, and patients from the Hadassah Hospital, which was the destination of the convoy. So he helped a lot of people
after
escape.
After the massacre, helped a bunch of people from the era escape.
Right.
So,
yeah. So to honor his efforts, the street leading to the hospital was actually changed to Churchill Boulevard. Because the Arab forces were attacking Jews in the area. He resumed his acting career in 1952 when he portrayed an archer in the film Ivanhoe, which was an MGM movie. So, like, you know, kind of big name production. He taught in Australia at a military school where he took up surfing. He designed his own surfboard and was the first man to ride the waves of the River Severn in Great Britain. It had, like, a 5-foot tidal bore, was what it says. So
River waves?
Yeah. Yeah. He rode a wave in the river. First man to do so.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
He was the first man to ride a wave in a river.
No, in this particular river.
Oh, okay. I was going to say.
The River Severn, or Severn. I don't know how. It's S-E-V-E-R-N. In Great Britain. Yeah. But I guess surfing wasn't a huge, you know, a huge thing known about back.
No, it wasn't the biggest.
Yeah. But, yeah, like I said, designed his own board and fell in love with surfing and did that, like, up in, like, in his retirement years. So he's noted as, like, there are, like, biographies about him. He's noted as a pretty famous explorer and person, you know, like, okay, you know, like this League of Extraordinary Men or whatever, where there's like the Explorers Club and it's just like a bunch of old, like, hunters and people like that. Like, he would have definitely been in that. Like, that's totally him.
Are we thinking of the same thing? Isn't that the one where, like, Van Helsing is in it?
Well, it's the one with Sean Connery and the Invisible Man. Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah, I'm not, okay. But like in the, when the army dude or secret, whatever, the guy, CIA guy, goes to find Sean Connery's character, he's like in a hunting club in Africa, and he's like in this elite, like, adventurers club or guild or something like that, where it's like, you know, they've killed all these big game animals and, like, fought creatures with their bare hands and, like, yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that's,
yeah.
that's totally something he would do or where he would be.
Sure. Yeah,
so we have soldier, we have newspaper editor, male model, surfer, instructor, actor.
You're just reading his Twitter bio?
Yeah. Father, lover. No. And then died at 89 years old in our lifetime, presumably. I don't know, you know. So it's,
yeah.
That's what a wild ride. That's
insane. Yeah.
Yeah. Just like the story just got crazier as I went.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I mean, just also just, yeah, that quote of him, like, being very annoyed that the war had ended.
Yeah.
It's like, could have gone on.
It's like, we could have fought for 10 more years. You crazy? And they're like, no, you're crazy. We're not.
That wouldn't be a good thing.
We're fighting.
So please don't say things like
that. Yeah. Like, yeah. It's. But, yeah. So he's an odd fella. But, yeah, that's my story.
I love it.
Mm-hmm. So that'll be, what's your lady's name? Susanna
M. Salter.
It was Mackenzie, right? Was her middle name or maiden name?
It wasn't Mackenzie. It was something else. But Susanna M. Salter is how she's written everywhere.
Gotcha. Versus Mad Jack Churchill.
Nice. So go ahead, go to our Twitter and vote on which of those was the strangest story. Mm-hmm. I think they're both strong contenders. Very different. I would say more extreme with Mystic Story, but more groundbreaking in America's history.
Yeah, very significant events in Broomies.
but yeah. Anyway, please do that if you would. If not, we understand. But yeah, I wanted to end this episode by saying, you know, the world has been pretty intense lately, especially here in America.
Yeah.
And I just want anybody listening to know that, like, we hope you're okay.
Yeah, yeah.
We believe in the Black Lives Matter movement. And I personally am, like, the hope I have for, like, the country right now is kind of like is in the protests that are still happening 20 some days after their initial beginning. So I'm very heartened by that. Of course, I'm very disheartened by everything else.
I mean, I read a statistic the other day that said since the protests have started, 120 people have been killed by police in 20 days. So not all of them are directly tied to the protests, but they're still cases of like police brutality or, you know, so it's, I mean, it's protestable things. And I just kind of want to say like, take care of yourselves. Like, there, I think it's very easy to have the mindset or like to feel pressure that like if you're not angry all the time, then you're not like really motivated or whatever. But like, you gotta take some time to like recover and like balance your own mental health as well, because things are so horrible. And so like, just because you might need to like take a break from the news or something like that, like because you're being affected emotionally, like, that doesn't mean that you don't care about what's going on. Like, obviously, you know, do what you can to make a difference. And, like, if you can donate to like, bail funds and things like that, or you know, please do that. And, like,
sign petitions,
do petitions and, like, work on policy change. But, like, you don't have to, for, like, every single minute, every second, like, be – that's so straining and then, like, emotionally damaging. Yeah. Like, you need to – like, in the long run, you need to be able to continue this. So take breaks. Every do time... things for yourselves. Yeah.
Every time I look at Twitter, I'm angry.
Yeah, I had to, I'm like, I need to delete my Facebook because, like, every article is just, like, stupid. Even things I see people, like, that I know, like, reposting, and I'm like, how do you miss the point so much? So it can be, like, very discouraging and very, so, like, that's kind of what, you know, the podcast was just begun because it was something crazy and fun to do, and like, it's something we both enjoy and have a passion for, and like, weird things, and we're, you know, our friendship is something fun to do together. But like, during this time, like, we hope that you can listen to it and just kind of disengage and like just listen to some funny things or weird things. And
we're not gonna go deep into this very much in the future. We might touch on it, but it's
but we want to acknowledge that it's happening. And
because it's a real, it's just reality does have to peek its head in, and we want to voice our support for the cause.
I do believe, you know, I kind of, I'm not saying that, I'm not trying to compare us to celebrities or anything, but like, you know, people get tired or fed up or disgruntled when celebrities use their fame and success as a platform for social change. But like, why wouldn't you? Like, why? So, you know, even if we only, like, however big or small this podcast is or ever gets, like, we do want to lend our voice to saying that Black Lives Matter, and try to, we want to stand up for what's right and advocate that.
I mean, at the very least, I just want to be one of the people that you hear saying it.
Because there are a lot of voices that are disagreeing.
Yes. So I just want to let everybody know.
Yeah, let's affirm that.
We support you. We love you.
Yeah.
stay safe.
Yeah, please.
And we'll see you on the next one.